Hello, I'm Amy Pryor. I'm the Technical Director at the Thames Estuary Partnership, and I was also co-producer of the Living Thames documentary. At the Thames Estuary Partnership, we work across the tidal Thames from Chelsea Bridge all the way down to Shoeburyness and Sheerness in Essex and Kent. And we were set up in order to make sure that the management and the enhancement of the river was done in an integrated way across all the different agendas and all the different interests that exist on the land and in the water. And we try and find that balance between environment, society, and economic needs.
Well, hello, my name's Steve Colclough. I spent 35 years in the Environment Agency becoming a national specialist in fish ecology and estuaries. I'm now a self-employed consultant, but I also am chair of a specialist section of the Institute of Fisheries Management, which is promoting estuarine and marine fisheries. Because what a lot of people don't realise when they look over that into that muddy water is that's a major nursery ground for a lot of marine fish, basically. And it's something the public wouldn't understand at all. So a lot of what I do these days is education and promotion and technical support.
Fantastic. We're here to talk about biodiversity. What, in your opinion, is the importance of biodiversity? Let's start with biodiversity on the in the river. So why do you think biodiversity is important for the river?
See, it's actually a really interesting question in its own right. What we know as ecologists now is that estuaries are some of the most fertile aquatic ecosystems on the planet. So in their own right, they're incredibly important. So, but it's promoting that in ways that people understand. Something I just said about marine fish that people won't know is the Thames is now the largest Dover sole nursery on the east coast of England and the largest sea bass nursery in the southern North Sea. Now, in economic terms, socio-economic terms, that's really important, not just for the Thames, but for the wider southeast. But it's something that people don't understand. So there's just one little aspect of biodiversity that is hidden, basically.
Well, I used to get asked this question a lot, like back in the early days. Marine biology is my background, worked with commercial fisheries and across marine conservation for all my professional life, basically. And when I first started working on the Thames over 12 years ago, people used to ask me that question, what does biodiversity mean and why is it important, both to wildlife but also to us as humans, like why should we care, basically? And it's been a while since I've had to talk about it, to be honest. I was trying to remember all the different metaphors I used to use. And essentially, the one that resonates with me is that biodiversity, the word, actually means variety of life. And nature likes a variety of life for various different reasons. So if we think of the Thames, it's not an isolated river. It's not an isolated system. It's part of the global Earth system. It's actually part of the ocean. So in essence, on the two tides we have every day on the tidal Thames, that's the ocean reaching up into the city, saying hello and then going back out again. But in that water body, there's a huge variety of life, high biodiversity basically in the true essence of the word. But when you think about all the different types of habitats, the water column itself, the mud flats, the salt marshes, which you've mentioned already, they're not only home to all the different fish species, marine mammals, and all the little critters in the mud that we have, they're also, those individual species actually have a role for that habitat as well. So in essence, everything's evolved to be here for a reason. Everything has a role, everything has a niche, whether it's a predator keeping down the numbers of other types of animals, or it's a fish that the way that it feeds in a salt marsh, it agitates the soil and it helps to propagate different seeds so that habitat can grow. Everything's here for a reason, and the more that there is, the broader variety of life, not only is that an indicator of the health of that environment, and in this case the river, it's also an indication of how resilient it can be to future shocks. And resilience itself, that means like being able to withstand something, right? It means being strong and being able to withstand a shock. And in the case of a shock on the river, it might be a pollution event, it might be a flooding event, or the big one that everybody has finally cottoned onto, climate change. So the broader our biodiversity, our wildlife, the stronger it will be to be able to withstand shocks and then, you know, give us the services and give us the support that we need to thrive as human beings.
Just to pick up on one point you mentioned there, which I'd like to just describe, and that's around continuity. When we're looking at biodiversity, one of the issues in the past, we've tended to look at habitats as being discrete and separate.
Yeah.
And the very live fish shows that that isn't the case. So to use two examples from my background, fish, you've got young of the year flounder, born at somewhere off Southend, we think, but at 8 millimetre in size. They're using the tides selectively to get all the way to Teddington, but they can barely swim.
So 8 millimetres is what? About
that long.
About that, isn't it?
They can barely swim, but what they know is the tide goes in and out. Yeah. So with a 13-kilometre tidal excursion, they can take a surf for 13 kilometres on a flooding tide, sit on the bottom while it ebbs, and do it again on the next flood. Continuity. Also, I mentioned sea bass before. This year's sea bass fry coming into the river at maybe 15 millimetre, they'll go all the way to Teddington, but they might have been born somewhere off the coast of France. So this is connectivity. Absolutely. These are not isolated areas at all. And it's something that it's not just the general public don't realise, but in regulatory terms in the past, we've tended to look at islands of habitat. And to pick up your point about climate change, there is no good, for example, protecting some reserve in, say, Africa for elephants. If it's got so warm and dry, they've just walked off somewhere else. It's the same here. We have to manage climate change because things are moving all the time. Yeah. And being cold water animals, they're moving in the sea faster than they are on land.
Yeah, that's true. So here, you once said to me that you think that the Thames, this is just your personal opinion, isn't it? But the Thames is at essentially its highest end of the temperature range that the current species can withstand. So we're going to probably see a lot of change, aren't we, in the coming decades as to the different types of fish and animals that we'll have in the river. And I think if we can go on to why is biodiversity important for humans, I think this is a really important point. So in our business, we talk a lot about ecosystem services, which is a very dry phrase for basically saying, what does the environment do for us? And the river is part of the global ocean, as I said, and the ocean gives us 50% of our oxygen. So essentially, it's like the beating blue heart of the city, in my opinion. That's the way I like to think about it. Even though it's not blue, it's brown, but it's meant to be brown because it's tidal. So it lifts the sediment up into the water, and that sediment mixes with the water, and it's naturally brown, isn't it? So its colour is not an indication of how healthy it is. Just to go back on the point about the river and biodiversity, this is a really positive recovery story, isn't it, of how we've enabled a major estuary to go from what was considered biologically dead in the 60s to having now over 125 species of fish, a couple of species of seal, dolphins, harbour porpoise, and all the little critters you can't see that live in the mud. So, you know, you had a major role in that, didn't you, throughout your professional life?
Yeah, I'm pleased to be associated with the Thames since the early 80s. But just pick up on something you just mentioned then as well. And this is, again, people's perception. The very first time that dolphins were seen at Greenwich, there were people phoning the RSPCA to say, come and rescue them and take them away. They're lost. No, they're not. They're an apex predator. They've come in because there's so many small fish in that reach. They're part of biodiversity. But again, people don't understand that. So education is key. Just something else I'd say as well here is that in the past it hasn't been just man's pollution that has destroyed the river, it's what else we've done to it. And this is a good example. Here behind us we have Tower Bridge. If you're standing on that bridge at low tide, it's a quarter of its width in Roman times. So that's just 2,000 years of us taking a little bit more land for development or wharfage or whatever. Now that might be entirely understandable, but bear in mind what I said about how those little flounder migrate up a river. You're making that whole migratory pathway just that much more difficult every time you encroach. So there is now a planning policy to try and resist further encroachment on those sort of reasons, and also because of climate change and sea level rise.
So essentially that encroachment, that building, has actually made the river deeper and the water flow faster, hasn't it?
And also, in the original form, what you would have seen 3,000 years ago is these green edges, these salt marshes going back. Now, those are actually the major nursery grounds. So, A, we've lost them, and we've lost 80% of the salt marshes across Western Europe in the last 200 years. But B, what we now know is those salt marshes are also extremely good at carbon sequestration. Yes, and we've lost all that sort of functionality. Mm. We need to put some of that back in the future to counter sea level rise. So we're getting multiple pluses. So we must never think of just one ecosystem service. Yeah. It's this whole range of them. It's a broad spectrum.
You mentioned carbon sequestration, that's a real biggie, and that's something that we're only really just starting to get a handle on now in terms of marine and estuary habitats. So there's carbon sequestration, there's what we call pollution attenuation. So
salt marshes are very good at stripping nutrients out, for example.
Absolutely, so nitrates and phosphates that come off the land, come off of farming, for example. So they're very good at utilising those, so they're not sitting in the water, and that's good for all the other species in the river, because nitrates and phosphates strip oxygen out of the water. There's also a lot of chemicals come on off the roads, don't they, from tyres and cars, basically. So there's a certain amount of stripping out of those pollutants as well. There's oxygen provision, there's and then the two biggies really for humans is the most obvious one, food. So without, as you mentioned earlier, especially down in the lower half of the river, there's nursery areas of salt marshes that basically are where baby fish grow so that they're up to a reproductive age and they can shelter in there on the high tides to get away from predators. And that feeds the commercial fish stocks of the North Sea and the Southern North Sea. So we have a thriving commercial fisheries down in Essex and Kent and up around the Greater Thames Estuary. And then obviously there's other fishing communities further up. So the fish that we are essentially are nursing, we're looking after, custodians of in the tidal Thames, are what you might actually eat on your plate in a few years' time. So when you think of globally, there's something, I can't remember the stats now, but there's something like 40% of the world's population rely on marine fish and estuarine fish for their main source of protein. And as you mentioned also, all these fish are starting to move around because the temperatures are changing in the global ocean and the Thames part of the global ocean. The temperatures are changing here too. Plankton's on the move north. The fish species that we're used to eating in this country, so cod is a big example of that, and haddock. Cod eats plankton, they're going to follow and other smaller fishes. So they're going to follow follow the plankton, basically, aren't they?
You just mentioned Dover sole and bass.
Yeah.
Yes, we had them here in the past, but not the numbers we have today. Yeah. They're warm water species moving up and the cod's gone further north. Just another thing, I'm just looking at the water, just reminding me, another big challenge we have in estuaries and trying to tell people how important they are is look at the water, it looks muddy. Yeah. Therefore, it must be polluted, surely. No, it isn't. Take a jam jar full of it and it goes clear within 5 minutes because it settles out. It's just mud in suspension. That's what estuaries do. They're clear at the top and they're clear at the bottom, but this bit in the middle, as the tide goes in and out, is always looking muddy. It'll look muddy if we weren't here. But people assume that means it's polluted. It's a really powerful image, though.
Absolutely, and that's actually part of why it's so good for nature in the river, because that suspended mud means all the critters in the mud are also suspended, so the fish are having basically got a smorgasbord every day, haven't they?
But the reason I mentioned the point, Amy, was that in my experience, if you clean up an urban freshwater stream, so it starts to look better and it starts to get water planted, it starts to get fish, you start to get birds associated, the public see it and can become very, very protective. I'd mention the River Wandle in particular, or the Ravensbourne. These positive processes have happened there in London. But when the same public look at the estuary, they say, I know you're telling me there's 125 species of fish, but it's muddy. Yeah. It's a really challenging issue.
And also they don't want to eat the fish out of the river.
A lot of people who eat in, say, a fish restaurant down in, say, Southend would have no idea that they're Dover sole come right off their frontage. They thought it's come from somewhere else, somewhere cleaner and nicer, but that's where they live.
And it would probably put them off knowing that it'd come from the Thames because of that misconception that it's dirty. Yeah. The other major service I think that people don't talk about enough is that essentially humans are connected to nature. Yeah. And here in the city, we're very disconnected from it in a very meaningful way, both physically and psychologically, because of the sort of urban sprawl and the greyness of the city. And we're blessed with lots of pocket parks and big parks on the land. But when it comes to the river, it's hard to get across that message that it's worth fighting for, it's worth looking after. It is moderately clean, there's still issues, but in terms of its cleanliness, it supports a huge variety of life, so that's a really good indicator. But it's really hard to get people to care. And some of the green, I'm going to call them green spaces, the intertidal habitat that we've built as part of our flood defence, that goes a long way to helping make that connection in people's minds.
when you look at the tidal Thames, because of the way we've dealt with the walls and pushed them back, most people are looking at a river down there. And there aren't many ways to get down to it. Now, in the few there are, and the beach at Greenwich is a classic, where you can walk down the beach. Today, there are people dog walking, taking their children down there, whole school classes going down there. That's what we need to encourage, to have more people being physically associated with their river. You and I both have seen paintings of hundreds of people on the foreshore of the Thames in the 1600s, even in the 1900s. Yeah. That's how it's associated with their river. But we're now hiding behind these high walls and thinking, oh, it looks a bit dirty and dangerous down there. Mm. But it's really significant that where people can make access, they're starting to. Just up the river here from the Founders Arms, for example, on a hot summer's evening, some of the drinkers just spill down onto the beach. Now, it might not be very safe there, but it demonstrates that people want to associate with the river.
Absolutely.
There's a strong need there in the human form to be close to water.
Absolutely. And there's a lot of science around that now. So I think it is becoming much more mainstream thinking, that whole get outside, get connected to nature, especially during the pandemic and the lockdowns that we've endured. We saw much larger numbers of people making the effort, essentially, to go and walk along their river and go out to their local parks, or the different rivers, around London, and certainly along the Thames. The Thames Path apparently was really, really busy at different points during the lockdown. You've talked about the power of education and environmental education, but physical access and knowledge access is a really big issue, I think. Certainly in somewhere as busy as London, because how do you get through to people so that they can understand? And part of that's what Totally Thames Festival is just so great for, is that it really gives a platform and highlights all the different activities you can do, but also all the different ways you can get involved in your day-to-day life. Whether that's volunteering on a weekend because you've got some spare time with someone like, with an organisation like Thames 21 to do a litter pick, or coming on a boat trip with us that we usually do in September, but we haven't managed to pull off this year. Accessing Thames Estuary Partnership's virtual tour. We've got a digital map that has lots of different points. We tried to emulate all the different things we would say on a boat trip that we would traditionally do every year with you. And so it's just an easy way for you to dip in and out, look at videos, look at information about the river and its human history as well as natural history and wildlife. And I think it just gives a platform for all these different voices and all these different myriad aspects of what really makes the Thames so vibrant. And for me, I'm an environmentalist at heart. It's, I get excited about the idea that the river is thriving with wildlife. But also the culture. I mean, the river built the city. London is here because of the Thames Estuary. And that's the same with estuaries throughout the world. You find major cities either at the top of them or somewhere along the banks because of that link with maritime trade. And I think, if you can think when you're sat at home or you're on your way to the shops or you're on your way to work, what's the one thing I can do that would actually help the health of the river and make and ensure that the river can carry on thriving and doing good things for me? There's little things like don't buy single-use plastic products, make sandwiches at home or carry a refillable water bottle.
I would just make one plea that if you want a single point of contact in the Thames to get involved, and I'm not choosing favourites here, but I've been involved with Thames 21, Thames Estuary Partnership and others over the year. These organisations play a pivotal role in the Thames. For example, with the Thames Estuary Partnership, an estuary management plan process, this is what it is, they were originally set up because there are so many partners and conflicts and difficulties on estuaries, because you're moving from a terrestrial landscape to a marine one, and the various organisations don't know each other very well. You need a consensus building approach that can involve people, and that's what TEP do magnificently.
Oh, didn't ask him to say that.